We have a lot to go through today. I want to welcome everyone to this week's Rising Tide Foundation lecture, where we will continue the fourth movement, where Pascal went through a comprehensive presentation last week on Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And originally, the idea was to have both Franklin Roosevelt and John F. Kennedy featured together in one presentation, describing and showcasing where they come from, what were the traditions that both of them tapped into that they tried to revive in their own times during the 20th century. In the case of Franklin Roosevelt, had his grand vision, his grand design that Pascal went through not been sabotaged, it is demonstrable that the thing that became known as the Cold War never would have happened. Pascal did a very good job of going through that, but there was so much material. Pascal called me last minute saying, I've got to give this in two classes. It's just too much. So luckily we had this opening spot today, which worked out beautifully well. And so since the Cold War unnaturally did become our fate in the 20th century, it was appropriate that we look at the life of John F. Kennedy. And, you know, in the course of the last weeks, we've brushed up against other anti-imperialists who had a concept as statesmen of a win-win world of cooperation and harmony and brotherhood, much more in alignment with natural law, both in Africa and Europe and beyond. John F. Kennedy is very misunderstood in current society. And I think that there's many, many decades of misinformation, of propaganda, both overly glorifying him as an angel with no problems, which also does a great disservice to JFK as a man who actually fought, who overcame challenges and who rose to great heights to take up a certain challenges that were put on his doorstep. And then other narratives that which malign him as either a communist sympathizer or as a cold warrior with, you know, an imperialistic mindset or a mafia tool or whatever else. There's so many things, so many narratives that clutter the landscape of truth. So for that alone, I'm very happy that Pascal is going to continue the story with the second of his two acts. And with that, Pascal, it's all yours.
All right. So I'm going to share my screen. Okay. 1 second. Can you all see this?
Yes.
No. Okay, good. Excellent. All right, that's just a joke to start. Because I mean, we're going to be discussing some serious things today, but I think it's always good to reflect on where we're at when we look at the past and what are the issues today. So anyway, everybody read it? Good.
It's a good joke.
I really like, what's his name? The guy who did, who does Dilbert. Anyway, he's really good contemporary issues.
Scott Adams, right?
Scott Adams, yeah, that's right. Okay. So yeah, as Matthew has said previously, I was supposed to do this in one part, but it was just too much. And, you know, even today, I'm going to try to do my best, but there's a lot that I won't be able to cover, or I will cover, but like in such a light fashion that, you know, it's, we'll see. I'll try to manage it. So Act Two, Kennedy and the New Frontier. The fall, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves that we are underlings. So for those who are familiar with Shakespeare, that's from Julius Caesar, Cassius talking to Brutus, telling him, you know, well, basically gauging him, see if he's up to the challenge of killing Caesar and taking the power. So when we look at the stars, when we look at our problems, when we look at the past, it's always good to reflect on us and what we're doing to try to solve our problems. So Kennedy, you know, and the New Frontier, an everlasting brief note, because As you understand, last week I did FDR. FDR was there for four terms as president, and you know, Kennedy was not able to finish his first. So it's not exactly the same, but as Matthew said, there's a lot that's been said on Kennedy, for good or for bad, a lot of disinformation, a lot of brushing off, you know, his character, his person, try to make it better than he was or worse. So we're going to look into this today. I wanted to, I found this, I thought it was pretty interesting. It was published in 1961 in the Des Moines Register. It's a little drawing that basically, you know, served to remind or go hand in hand with what Kennedy was doing at the time. So it pictures, you know, the spirit of 76 of the Declaration of Independence of the United States, and but also says, you know, that it's still up in 1961. So it goes, "Our freedoms were not handed to us to be enjoyed as gifts from our forefathers. They were fought for and established in 1776 and have been fought for and secured by each generation since. Our generation is no exception and must be willing to fight and sacrifice as its part, as its parts in a continuing struggle that began in 1776. So I thought that was fitting, because what Kennedy was asking the population at the time, what he was trying to do with the American population when he became president, was not just to you know, get the government to do everything. It was really to get the population to move against the status quo that had been created right after the death of FDR, and this kind of cancer that was growing in the population and in the elites in Washington, D.C. And it was a very precarious moment because, as you know, it was called the Cold War. It was the period of the Cold War. So atomic bombs had been dropped. That's after FDR, that's under Truman. Atomic bombs had been dropped on Japan, Hiroshima, Nagasaki. And the, you know, Second World War ended, or so did it, really. And that's what Kennedy was fighting against, this idea of continuing the war, fascism being defeated, now to go towards fighting communism with weapons, not with intelligence, but with weapons of mass destruction. And that's what that was his big struggle. That was a big fear, that the world could end, you know, the day after tomorrow. So let's go into this. So I would say that JFK was really going into the footsteps of FDR. He really, he was in the military. He served in the Pacific Theater during World War II. And I think he understood very well what FDR was trying to do. And as JFK was traveling around the United States, but around the world also before he was president, he noticed the lack of infrastructure, especially in you know, British and French colonies around the world. And so he was inspired by what FDR had done in the United States. in the homeland with the TVA and other projects during the New Deal of the 1930s, he was inspired to say, hey, let's do this. Still there's work to be done in the United States, but we have to share this with the whole world. Because if you want to fight communism, you have to provide a better alternative. And it's no doubt in my mind that Kennedy was really against communism, but he didn't see anything valid in the idea of fighting it with just pure force. So, there's pictures of Kennedy with Eleanor Roosevelt meeting. She was at the UN after the Second World War. She did a lot of pioneering work at the UN. And so they knew each other and they worked together. Okay, let's go back. So let's just look at the time of from the last class I gave. So we were discussing FDR and the British Empire. And so Winston Churchill lost. We're going to get to this. Sorry. Getting ahead of myself again. Winston Churchill spoke in front of the Parliament, the British Parliament, in 1942 and said, I have not become the King's first minister in order to preside over the liquidation of the British Empire. And there's a note from FDR to an aide which says in 1942, just right the day after that speech that Churchill gave to the British Parliament, FDR wrote a note that partly said, we're going to have worse trouble with Britain after the war than we do with Nazi Germany now. So that should bring you back into what FDR was trying to do, is understanding of the situation, because the fact was that Britain had been behind Nazi Germany before Hitler started invading everybody. And even at the beginning when Hitler was invading, what was annexing Austria and attacking Czechoslovakia. So FDR knew about this. He knew that the empire was only fighting for itself and for preservation of itself. So he knew that after the war, there'd be another battle with the British Empire to be fought. Luke?
Yes.
Can you read this?
Sure, I can read.
Thank you.
In Africa, in the Middle East, throughout the Arab world, as well as in China, and the whole East, or in the whole Far East, freedom means the orderly but scheduled abolition of the colonial system. When I say that, in order to have peace, this world must be free. I'm only reporting that a great process has started, which no man, certainly not Hitler, can stop. After centuries of ignorant and dull compliance, hundreds of millions of peoples in Eastern Europe and Asia have opened the books. Old fears no longer frighten them. They are resolved, as they must be, that there is no more place for imperialism within their own society than in the society of nations. The big house on the hill, surrounded by the mud huts, has lost its awesome charm.
Okay, so who said that?
I think it's FDR.
Okay.
Everyone is on mute, by the way, by default.
Yeah, by default. Okay. So I'll just give you the answer. It wasn't FDR, but it was Wendell Willkie, who was a Republican. And he was sent, FDR had sanctioned for him a world tour in 1942. So he came back and said that. So it gives you an idea that, you know, it was a concrete idea at the time, during the Second World War, of what was the cause of it, what was the problem with imperialism, colonialism, and that it had to be stopped and overturned. And so from the Republican side and the Democratic side, well, you know, the FDR Democrats, this was very well understood. And so this is also the generation, you know, which was in power and was organizing the young population of the time. So that's the leaders that, you know, that young JFK had and look up to. Now you know that FDR died, and so you had Churchill and Truman, because Churchill was really running more of the show than Truman. Churchill went to Fulton University, I believe it's in Missouri, right after the end of the Second World War. And, you know, the Cold War had already started. Already after the death of FDR, there was a split. And then the fear of communism was really peddled big time to get the population scared and you know, create a new enemy, create a new monster that had to be fought. So Churchill gave a speech in which, you know, it's the famous, famously called or infamously called Iron Curtain speech. And basically, if you didn't know at the time that the Cold War had started, well, with that speech, now you knew it was started. It was full on. And so now the fight was against communism. And Truman would just go along with it, really reversing the policies of Franklin Roosevelt for great development around the world. And it would just become an ally to British imperial forces that wanted to reconquer and keep control over their former colonies. Okay, so let's look at the Kennedys. Nice family portrait here. So you have all the kids with Joe Kennedy, his wife, and the dog. So everything's good. Who's John F. Kennedy? Well, just to give you you know, the bio, like I did last time with FDR. These are, you know, the hard facts. So, from Massachusetts, born 1917 to 1963, was a Democrat, and he was, you know, president for really not that long, January 20th, 1961 to November 22nd, 1963. I will refer to him as JFK, mostly. Okay, so the Kennedys. Joseph Patrick Kennedy, that's a father. Not such a great guy. So if I want to make the case that, you know, that JFK was great, was he great because he came from, you know, was he because he was the son of his father? Well, not quite. So Joseph Kennedy was really on the side of Wall Street. Even though FDR made him U.S. Security and Exchange Commission chair, and also sent him to the to be ambassador of the United States to the United Kingdom, really Joe Kennedy was not seen as a great guy. It was kind of like, you know, you're close to your friends, but you're even closer to your enemies. And FDR really had to be close to Joseph Kennedy to try to control him. And it wasn't that easy, as you see the quote on the neck on the right there. FDR spoke to his aide, James Farthing, 1939, and said, "That's when Joe Kennedy was ambassador to the United Kingdom." Said Joe has been taken in by the British government people and the royal family. He's more British than Walter Hines Page, who was the American ambassador to Britain in World War I, than Page was. The trouble with the British is that they have for several hundred years been controlled by the upper classes. The upper classes control all trade and commerce. Therefore, the policy of the British government relates entirely to the protection of this class. And so Joe Kennedy was very happy in England. He really liked it. And he was making a lot of connection with the British circles. And that really upset FDR. And Kennedy had to come back to the United States not too long after that. In 1940, he came back. So, okay, so Joe Kennedy was not really that good. He did, amass a huge fortune, with his friend on Wall Street. But yeah, that's not that great. Let's look further. Okay, so you have Patrick Joseph Kennedy. That's the grandfather on the Kennedy side. He was also very influential. A member of the Massachusetts House of Representatives, and also he was a member of the Senate, Massachusetts. So Kennedy really came from a family, was into politics, and had been for a long time in Massachusetts, in the Boston area. So in a sense, his way was already all traced up to the White House. And that was the ambition. That was the ambition that came from the Kennedy side, that he would be, not necessarily him first, but, that Kennedy once one day would become president. Okay, Patrick Kennedy, the great grandfather, the one that he was born in Ireland. And he sailed from Ireland to, by Liverpool and to Boston on the ship Washington Irving. He did that in 1849. And if you know that period in Ireland, 1845 to 50, around that, that's a potato famine. That's really a bad time to be in Ireland. And Ireland probably lost around 2/3 of its population at the time. Leaving or dying. So Patrick Kennedy was fairly poor when he left Ireland and went to work into Boston Harbor as a cooper, so making barrels and other stuff and casks and all that. Okay, so. Not a big millionaire there. Let's go on the mother side. So the mother connection. So the mother is Rose Elizabeth Fitzgerald, the King Kennedy. And her dad was John Francis Fitzgerald. That's where the Fitzgerald comes from. And he was the mayor of Boston. He was mayor of the U.S. House of Representatives and also in the Senate. He owned a newspaper. He bought a newspaper in Boston, which was going bankrupt, called The Republic. And he used it to really, well, to propel himself politically, but also to, in order to advance the rights of the Irishmen, to really organize the Irish population in his district and the Boston area. And he fought for Irishman rights, for Ireland, also for the independence of Ireland from the United States, you know, so home and abroad. So which one is which? Is Ireland home or the United States? So at the time, you know, they were fairly new in the United States, but they, so interestingly, on the mother's side, there's this character who was also very ambitious, but you know, really was steeped into a Republican idea for Ireland, and so was probably was very happy to be in the U.S. at the time. Oh, admit. Kennedy went to Ireland. I don't know if you knew that. He did visit Ireland in June 1963. And, you know, if you think about this, I'm not sure. I don't know exactly what Kennedy had in mind when he visited Ireland. But if you think about it, I should go back to this. Patrick Kennedy. Patrick Kennedy was from New Ross, County Wexford, right there, right? The dot, the red dot. And so Wexford County was very important in 1798. Actually, that's where the Battle of Vinegar Hill happened. That was during the Irish Rebellion. So an attempt at independence from England. And so, you know, there were many, many rebellions, many attempts from the Irish people to try to break from the empire, try to become independent. I just listed a few of them until 1922 when they had the Irish Republic. And still, you know, things were not completely settled, but and it caused a lot of trouble after that, but probably Kennedy would have been very knowledgeable about the 1916 Easter Rising and the aspirations of the Irish people at the time. He was able to converse with a lot of Irishmen when he was in when Joe Kennedy was ambassador to England, to the UK, because he was there with him. And interestingly, the picture on the bottom right, that's what Kennedy spoke to the Irish Parliament. He presented a banner, which was the banner of the Irish Brigade, which for a brigade who fought during the American Civil War on the side of the Union. So it was something that certainly he knew about. And so you know, I wonder everything that was going through his mind as he was traveling to the homeland, to Ireland, to the home of his great-grandfather. He probably had a lot of that in his mind. And we'll see that he understood the problem of imperialism, not just when he was president, but way before that. So we'll continue. Oops. Yes, sorry. Oh, just the picture. I should say one thing about the picture up. So up on the right, there was this Commodore John Barry, who was born in that area of County Wexford, and he fought. He was there with John Paul Jones at the time of the American Revolution, creating the American Navy. So they had a ceremony at his statue in that area of Wexford or very close to New Ross, because that's where he was from. And so Kennedy was there and laid a wreath at the monument at the statue. So that's also very interesting how the Irish in the American Revolution, how they helped. So JFK goes to Washington. He spoke in 1945, so right after the Second World War has ended. He's pushing to go into the House of Representatives, and he gives some remarks. I believe it's at the Cross-Competition American Legion Post. So I guess it's a text that he wrote. He was going into England, Ireland, and Germany, and what they were expected to become after the in the post-war era. And that's right at the time when Churchill had lost his the elections. The Conservative Party had lost, and the Labour was in power now in England. So Kennedy reflected on that, and he said, well, you know, the Conservative, well, I'll just read the quote. Where Roosevelt made his political reputation by his treatment of the Depression, the Conservative Party lost theirs. So basically, the policy of England, of the oligarchy in England, had kept people really, really poor. And even during the crisis after the crash in 1929 and 30s depression, nothing much was done. It was really the war which got the people out of the depression. So not much was done for the people, and the British were really looking to become the population. The British people were really looking at America and what had been done, and they wanted the same for them. And so the Conservative had really not done much, and were not expecting to do more. So they lost. And another quote from that article is Kennedy says, that arch Tory, Benjamin Disraeli, Earl of Beaconsfield, once stated that England was divided into two nations, the rich and the poor. Although Mr. Lasky, Labour, may talk about the new foreign policy of socialism, Britain stands today as Britain has always stood, for the empire. So that's in 1945. That's what Kennedy says, right when he's running for Congress, going to Washington, and he has an understanding that the British Empire is not dead yet, and whether it's a Conservative or a Labour prime minister that's in, they will do what the Empire wants. So that's an issue. That's what American people should know about. And that's what he wrote at the time. So he becomes congressman. And eventually he's going to be going on a tour. He goes to Asia, he goes to the Middle East, and he goes around and he tries to investigate what's going on, tries to understand a bit more the situation on the ground, not just by reading reports or books, which, you know, it's always good, but go to see, check it for yourself on the ground. And he is not very, well, I guess he's surprised, but he's not really delighted by what he sees. And so he reports to the Congress and to the people. He says, our intervention in behalf of England's oil investments in Iran, directed more at the preservation of interests outside Iran than at Iran's own development, is certainly not a good idea. That's what he's exposing. So he's telling people that the United States is not on the good side right now. It's not helping the people, whether it's in Iran or elsewhere. It is on the side of the British interests, of outside interests. And that can't work. That's not going to work. That's not what America should stand for. That's not what, you know, they were doing or were planning to do after the World War. He continues saying, I saw an area in which poverty and sickness and disease are rampant. Injustice and inequality are old and ingrained, and the fires of nationalism are now ablaze. After being for 100 years and more the source of empire for Western Europe, for England and France and Holland. The East of today is no longer the East of Palmerston and Disraeli. We want allies in ideas, in resources, even in arms. But if we would have allies, we must first of all gather to ourselves friends. So yeah, so what kind of policies you need to put in place if you want to have friends around the world? Are you going to support England, France, and Holland? Are you going to, you know, become an empire yourself, supplant them? Or, you know, are you going to have a different policy and fight colonialism, really try to create in the spirit of 76, new republics with which you could ally yourself? So that's Kennedy in 1951. He's a congressman. He also gave a speech, but I'm not going to have an excerpt right now. And so one of the fight, you know, clearly JFK was an anti-imperialist. And he delivered a speech in the Senate in 1957. So now he was a senator. He became senator, I believe, around 54, around there, he became senator. And I really wrote this quickly. So he became really a most important ally to anti-imperialist forces outside of America, and it is said that he was well known around the world, much better known around the world, you know, by these circles, by the people, than he was to the American people before he became president. And so I should rewrite the whole slide. Sorry. So the third world, or the oppressed world, could look up to. It was really the greatest ally they could look up to at the time. And so that's something that I don't really hear about. And I don't really read in history books. I looked into different history books. I thought I had, you know, a good collection of them, and it's not really that great. It's they always discuss you know, when he becomes president, but not much in the ideas, not much in the alliances, and not at all at what he was doing before he became president. So that's something that has to be looked into if you really want to understand what Kennedy was trying to do, where he came from and where he was trying to propel the United States at the time. That's a very interesting quote that I thought, you know, coming from a U.S. president. JFK was invited at the Book and Authors Club luncheon in Cleveland, Ohio. That was in 1958. And so he said, "Poets," wrote Shelley at the conclusion of his defense of poetry, "are the unacknowledged legislators of the world. This is truer than most legislators are willing to admit. But if more politicians knew poetry and more poets knew politics, I am convinced the world would be a little better place to live on this 20th day of February, 1958. And so really that gives you another side of him where he really, and you know, to a large extent, Robert Kennedy too, although I'm not gonna get into this right now, were really well versed into poetry and the classics, really Greek and Latin classics, and so also the British poet Shelley, and I think there's a lot that, you know, has to be reflected, you know, after that quote, what Kennedy was trying to say, what Shelley is saying, what Kennedy is saying, what he's doing, how he's actually putting that into action in the 1960s. What kind of hope was Kennedy bringing to the population, the U.S. population certainly, and the world, you know, overall in the world? What, you know, the youth of the time, the American youth, saw in him, and what he was able to communicate to them, and it is, you know, it is said, you know, that Kennedy was not so good at writing. Well, he was a journalist, but it is said that he didn't write, you know, Courage, Profiles in Courage, the book that was published when he became when he was senator. I think that's just trying to brush on the side the qualities that really he had, not just to write well, but, you know, to also get people around him who would help craft this message. And certainly he was helped. Actually, it's very interesting. I have read parts of Profiles in Courage to prepare the presentation. I'm not going to go really too much into this today, but right off, you know, at the beginning, Kennedy basically says, you know, I wrote the book, but really I was helped by many other people, and, you know, two historians and a lot of other people from around the country. So he's acknowledging, it's not like he didn't know, or, you know, people didn't know, but he wasn't the only one who had drafted parts of the book, but he wanted that book to be published to his name. So there's something to the ideas, not just the way it's written, you know, the nice, the quality of the writing, the rhetorical, you know, aspect to it, but it's really, what was he trying to get to people? Why was he discussing courage? And you know, as a senator from Massachusetts, what was he trying to achieve? And if you remember, I had a quote in the presentation of FDR on FDR, which was about the idea that a real leader, what's real leadership, is not just to lead people where they want to go, but it's actually to get them to understand where they have to go, how they're going to get there, most importantly, how we can achieve our goals. And so the leader has a responsibility, not just of, you know, winning elections and passing bills, but really has to educate the population. If he sees that the population is lacking understanding or lacking the broader perspective of where they're at, what the context is, what needs to be done. So I think that's what Kennedy was trying to do, and he was organizing people around him and organizing good people. Really, his speechwriter Sorensen really was a good writer and really helped him out. But I think that, you know, it was not just one guy writing speeches. Kennedy really was collaborating and wanted these speeches to be good, because he wanted the American people to move. He wanted to be understood and wanted action, and action now. So let's go on. Okay, let's go and talk a bit about the enemy. So I already introduced this idea that, you know, after the Second World War, after FDR had died, the British Empire was still there and had to be reckoned with. Something had to be done. But there were not just enemies on the outside. There were enemies in the inside. And so I call them the Cold War hawks. You know, those who wanted to really have a fight with the Soviet Union, wanted to destroy them, and thought it was possible right after the Second World War to just destroy them. These were, you know, the British Anglophiles parts of the establishment in the United States, very close to Churchill, but also the different kind of utopian or dystopians, as you could call them, like Bertrand Russell, H.G. Wells, we discussed a little bit in the past in my FDR presentation. So now on the American side, you had Alan Dulles of the OSS CIA, also known for the Iranian coup d'etat, the Guatemalan coup d'etat, the MKUltra program, also the Bay of Pigs invasion. And you had his brother, John Foster Dulles. They were on the Republican side of the aisle. And then you had Dean Acheson and Averell Harriman, who were on the Democratic side, but both were really following a same kind of modus operandi, where they were the imperial forces in the United States. They were the anti-FDR faction, which actually took over when FDR died. These were the ones who were running the foreign policies under Truman. All these coup d'etats, as you can see in the different programs. And of course, you had J. Edgar Hoover, was running the FBI, didn't write it in, but you know, he was on the FBI. He was basically the spy master. He was spying on all Americans to find the communists, and really bullying everybody in the Congress, the Senate, and every strata of the U.S. population. People were scared of this guy. because really what he was doing was just insanely anti-American and clearly anti-democratic. But, you know, this was what was launched after the death of FDR. These guys, these crazies, were able to get more control and try to basically, you know, create the government in their image, which was pretty ugly. I put in the Bay of Pigs, already mentioned beforehand, but really the idea of fighting communism everywhere. Not that Kennedy I think that he wanted to fight communism, but plans that were organized by these guys, like the assassinations, the coup d'etats and all that, that's really something that Kennedy had in awe. That's really something that he understood would not actually create the effect that were wanted by the American people, because the American people clearly didn't want wars. They were fed up with wars. And so to create more military coups, whether with the military per se or with the, you know, dirty operations ran by the CIA, that's not what he privileged. That's really not the way he wanted to go about it. And also, when just right before Kennedy was to go into office, there were attacks from the financial, on the financial side of things. The crew from London and Wall Street really wanted to destabilize the dollar. They, as we discussed last week, there was a system that was put in place at the end of the Second World War at the Bretton Woods Conference, where basically gold had a value of a monetary value in dollars, and people would go to the dollars instead of just exchanging gold. It would be backed by gold. It would be a gold reserve, but not a gold standard. And, you know, we might go back to this at the end in the question answer, but if you have questions. But really, the idea at the time when Kennedy became president, there was already an attack on him beforehand by these circles who wanted to devalue the dollar, devalue all currencies on the markets, and create just a new kind of depression, new kind of problems, where the administration, the incoming administration, could not actually go and build projects like he intended. So these are really the nasty enemies that Kennedy had to face right off the bat when he arrived at the presidency. Okay, more pictures of the Dulles. We were there, you know, as you see it with Eisenhower. They were ingrained. They were that was the imperial structure in the U.S., the imperial faction, which was already there. And Eisenhower, you know, did what he could, I guess, but didn't quite understand, I believe, what was up against the United States at the time. And, you know, his speech on the industrial, military industrial complex is interesting, but, you know, as a farewell address, it's kind of like, hey, you know, we have this problem. Now I've got to go. Bye. No, I don't know. You know, Kennedy was in big trouble when he came in. It was not an easy situation. And he was stopped from doing a lot of things, even, you know, in the short period he was there. He was not able to do really nearly as much as he wanted, I'm sure, because of these guys, the Dulles, Hoover, Ehrman, and all. Okay, so J. Edgar Hoover, FBI. Oh, I put the CIA. No. I don't know if you can see that. Number one, that's a leaflet that was distributed the day before Kennedy was shot in Dallas. That was distributed in Dallas. Number one, I don't know if you can read it, if it's clear on your screens.
Yeah,
you can see it? Okay, good. So I put it on the left-hand side, but, you know, treasonous to whom? Who was Kennedy treasonous to? Well, probably to, you know, the faction with which his dad allied. But if you look in the number one point, which is mentioned against Kennedy for treason, it says that he betrayed our friends in Katanga. Now, what the hell is Katanga? Is it in North Dakota or something? I don't think so. I'm sure Jerry is having a good laugh right now. I can't see, but no. Katanga is in Congo. It's in the Democratic Republic of Congo. What was the new Republic of Congo at the time? It was fairly new. And so why would you put that as your number one problem with Kennedy? You know, he betrayed our friends in Katanga. What was happening in Katanga? Well, Katanga is where copper and uranium is in Congo. And the French and Belgian were very interested there. And so Kennedy wasn't for the splitting of Katanga from Congo. Because that was the attempt. That was the attempt that was made at the time before Kennedy became president. And so he made clear that he was against that. And that was still reproached to him in 1963. It was still, you know, as you can see, one of the number one issue that whoever made that leaflet had against them. And so I thought that was very interesting that, you know, that would be one thing that was a big, you know, seen as treasonous coming from Kennedy. And obviously, you know, it was framed in the anti-communist language of the time. So Katanga, let's just talk a little bit more about this. I'll get back to it. You'll see fairly soon. But there was a president Lumumba at the time in Katanga, and he was trying to unify really the country, make it a republic. The Belgian had given the independence, but really reluctantly. And actually Lumumba was assassinated 3 days before Kennedy took office in for the presidency. 3 days before Kennedy was to be inaugurated, Lumumba was assassinated. It was a covert assassination. Kennedy only learned about this a few months later. And so Kennedy at the time had been really clear that he was against the splitting of Congo, and he was against the imperial factions, French, Belgian, and others, you know, British and others, which were really into trying to create mayhem in Africa. And we're going to go back into this a bit later. But I just thought that was very interesting to see. So what was the plan? Well, Kennedy was following really FDR, but he was also following Lincoln, and he was following John Quincy Adams. That's actually John Quincy Adams is the first profile in his book Profiles in Courage. And it's very interesting that you know, the affiliation there, I should have put them in different order, but John Quincy Adams, Lincoln and FDR, there's a clear affiliation between these US presidents. And what they were trying to attempt at, you know, in the different period they were presidents. And they had to break really from the popular ideas of the time. John Quincy Adams, who was, you know, was elected a Federalist at the time, had to break with his party and go on the side of Jefferson. And fight on the side of Jefferson, which was not the obvious thing to do, but it was a courageous thing, and he lost his Senate seat because of that. But it was required, really, for the young republic to continue, that people would break from the status quo and the party lines, especially the party lines. And that's what Kennedy was doing when he was writing against imperialism back in the 40s, 50s, before he became president. He was actually breaking from his party line, because the Democratic Party under Truman had just gone back to the Theodore Roosevelt policy, you know, as a junior partner with the British Empire. And JFK was against that. So he was breaking with the party line and with the establishment. And he was providing hope to the population, and really rekindling the spirit of what FDR was doing during the Depression. So it would go hand in hand with progress and peace. And the TVA, the example of the TVA, or a global TVA, a nationwide TVA, that was the plan. If you look at, we're not going to watch the videos right now, or the speeches. You know, I use quotes, but I would encourage everybody to just go and look at what Kennedy was saying. It was just the speeches, you know, in one setting, because it's one thing to use quotes, but really to understand where he's at, when, and what he says to the people there, it's much better. It's just it's great. And so you should go and check. Maybe I could send to people a list of different videos, but they are really important, of what he was saying.
Yeah, Pascal, if you could send a list of the best speeches, we'll put that in the description box under the video.
Great. Yes, I will, because there's just so much to go through, and I feel like, you know, my time already is I'm gonna go overboard. So. So just to, you know, these bullet points, the Peace Corps also was a great project. Congressman Cornelius Gallagher at the time was a close friend to the Kennedys, and he helped pass the Peace Corps Act, which was creating, really, if you think about it, the United States, when they were founded, there was this idea of the citizen soldier, like, you know, when everybody is talking about the Second Amendment and the militias and this and that, and what does that mean? Well, the idea was really that, you know, people, the citizen, would be in charge of protecting the land, and that went into this idea of engineering, this idea of a real progress, real technological progress and engineering. The idea also of the École Polytechnique, the French side of it. That's what West Point, the academy, West Point Military Academy was crafted upon. It was really to do the same thing as the École Polytechnique in France and create really a large amount of engineers who could protect and develop their land, their country, not just in terms of being good soldiers, but really understanding situations and being able to create the infrastructure needed to develop the country. So the Peace Corps was really a great enterprise, and a lot of young people went into this, not just to help build infrastructure in the US, but also around the world. They were really, that was part of the plan. And so I just, that's something also to look more into, but I wanted to mention it. And obviously people know Kennedy for space, for, today people think it's really, it was a run to have, to create a dictatorship from space or something like that, like to be the best. And have the capabilities and go to space and just take over. But that was not the plan, really. The idea, Kennedy was trying to launch, through the different corridors created, really like all the brains of the United States were to be put to work at creating new technologies, not just to go to space, but really to create a better understanding of the universe, get really the population of the world into the 20th century, and use that kind of technology to accomplish it. And so breakthrough sciences, that was to be the biggest weapon that Kennedy could yield against the empire, and that's what he did. When one of the speeches, of course, you should listen to the "We Want to Go to the Moon." The speech at Rice when he launches the space program, or make it the big announcement. That's really what people were looking towards. And that's American system economics. Just to go back to the first point, all of these are actually part of the American system of economics, TVA, Peace Corps, and space, and breakthrough science. That was to be, that's really looking at the best that the American Republican tradition could offer, and that's what Kennedy was betting on at the time. That was really, it was his best bet. That was the best thing to do in order to overthrow dictatorships, in order to prove that communism was not working. That's the way that they had to go. And there's so much more we could say, but I'm just going to hold it for now. Okay, I'm going to need another reader because I can't read on my screen. Sorry. But I would need people to read, one person to read the quote. I'm just going to read what I wrote on the left first, and then whoever wants to read it could go on. So, on avoiding Malthus's conclusion. Oh, and maybe you noticed I put some slides in green, and it's not just for Ireland, but mostly those to depict the Irish, where Kennedy came from. And the policies of Malthus had big impact on Ireland. So we're going to get to this, but yeah, that's why the slide is green. So on avoiding Malthus's conclusion, science, technology, and cooperation, the president proposed concerted international scientific work, new infrastructure, and nuclear power to solve such problems as resource development, protection from catastrophic weather, and overcoming poverty. So could somebody please?
I'll read it.
Thank you.
Malthus argued a century and a half ago that man, by using up all his available resources, would forever press on the limits of subsistence, thus condemning humanity to an indefinite future of misery and poverty. We can now begin to hope, and I believe, know that Malthus was expressing not a law of nature, but merely the limitation then of scientific and social wisdom. The truth or falsity of Malthus's prediction will depend now, with the tools we have, on our own actions. The earth can be an abundant mother to all of the people that will be born in the coming years. Abundance depends now on the application of sound biological analysis to the problems of agriculture and the long-term answer to inadequate food production, which brings misery with it, must lie in new research and new experimentation, and the successful use of new knowledge will require close cooperation with other nations. This is from JFK's addressing the National Academy of Sciences, October 22nd, 1963.
Yeah, so 1 month before he was assassinated, right? 1 month. And so he was pretty clear. That's a very interesting jab at the British system, because Malthus predicted that, you know, food supply would run out because population was growing in a geometric fashion, and food supply was growing in a arithmetic fashion. So the two curves, or the line and the curve, would cross, and it would create mass starvation. But that's only true if you stop developing yourself and your the sciences, the technologies that you have to grow the food, and your understanding of nature. So JFK was pretty clear on this, and that's also, just to be clear, that's really how the American system of political economy was designed by Alexander Hamilton. That was really the intention at the beginning, and it was right. At the same time, Malthus was writing at the end of the 18th century, 1799, I believe, was published his book on population. And so Alexander Hamilton, you know, was there at the same time, and had a completely different idea. And that policy, the Malthusian policy, was exactly what the British Empire would use in its colonies and in Ireland, to create starvation, to create chaos, and really genocide, really a genocidal policy. That's Malthus was the theoretical framework from which the empire was basically plotting the population, and still to this day. Because when you look at the green policies that are peddled around, this comes exactly from Malthus, from the idea that there's not enough resources for everybody, and that there's too many people, and that obviously when there's too many people and not enough resources, well, you know, there's war, chaos, and starvation. So Kennedy understood this, and he knew what was the remedy to it. And you know, think back to the space program, that was part of it. That was, think about how space right now is actually helping in agriculture, how the farmers are actually using satellites to improve their crops. Well, that come from there. So Kennedy understood this, and he had he did speak about conservation. He did speak about conservation, yeah. But his idea was very far from being the same as Theodore Roosevelt was promoting at the beginning of the 20th century. You know, because conservation could be described in the first part as, you know, you keep your resources, you try to manage them so you always have enough. So you protect it and you just, you know, put some aside, and that's conservation. You don't develop too much. You try to be, you know, on the equilibrium side of things. That's what people, you know, they still say today. You don't want to do too much. You don't want to use too much. Well, okay, that's the first idea of conservation. Kennedy was still using that term, but not in the, you know, in the fashion that we call, you know, today the green ideology. He really had an idea, a very different idea of conservation. And in his speech in Hanford on September 26th, he said, "But the other part of conservation is the newer part, and that is to use science and technology to achieve significant breakthroughs, as we are doing today. And in that way, to conserve the resources which 10 or 20 or 30 years ago may have been wholly unknown." So that's something very important. The atomic age brought something completely new. And even though, you know, there was a lot of fear of what, you know, the atomic energy, the, you know, obviously the bomb, everybody was talking about the bomb. It was the Cold War, so everybody was freaking out. If you think about the Bay of Pigs, the showdown that had gone, you know, right at the beginning of his presidency. So Kennedy was well aware of all of this, but he was saying also, well, we need that technology to be used everywhere. And everywhere, this will bring about the breakthroughs that are needed so that we live in peace. You know, the idea of atoms for peace, that's where it came from. So the problem he knew was, you know, the lack of energy, the lack of power, capability of, you know, doing the work needed to industrialize, not just, you know, to promote and continue the industrialization of America, but also to export it around the world, to have other nations become a powerhouse of their own. And so nuclear energy and the space program were big in this program, in his view of the long-term development of the U.S. and the world. And he went, I wanted to mention that, he did a tour of the West, Colorado, Nevada, and was it Arkansas? I'm not sure. He went different places. He did a tour of the Western states of the United States, California also, and I believe Washington State. But he really had this idea of a complete whole. He didn't want the United States to be, you know, the states fighting each other. And he really made clear in his speeches, which you should listen to, that these projects were not just good for one state, but were good for all of the states, all of the Union, all of the American Republic. And this is how the United States should see it, the American people should look at it, so that they would actually reflect it on the whole world and understand that what is good for Congo is also good for America. What is good for Saudi Arabia, what is good for Syria, what is good for the whole Middle East is also good for America. And so development of these technologies all around the world would have a great impact on the United States. But he said, you know, but in the U.S., we should lead it. we should be the leader of this. So it was the earth, the moon, and beyond. And so you remember that's the Rice, that's from the Rice speech, the acceptance of Democratic nomination for president in July 15, 1960, which became the New Frontier speech. So he discussed that, you know, the New Frontier was not the West, but now the space. And so he said, the New Frontier of which I speak is not a set of promises. It is a set of challenges. It sums up not what I intend to offer the American people, but what I intend to ask of them. So this was really, he was organizing the population as FDR had challenged the American population, has organized them through, you know, the fireside chats and what he was doing. Well, Kennedy was using also the media of his time to set challenges and to confront the American people on what they had to do. What was the problem at the time, and what was lacking? So that was you know that's what people still remember today of him, which is, you know, it's good. It's not all, but you know. It's already it's pretty inspiring if you don't look at it with your green glasses. All right, something else that's not really discussed much is also what Kennedy was doing around the world, who he was talking to, who he was organizing. Because he liked dams in the United States, thought they were useful, but he also wanted to help other countries to build dams and generate electrical power. So he was a good friend to Kwame Nkrumah, the president of Ghana, who had studied under FDR in the United States. He was there during the FDR presidency, a young student then, and he became the president of Ghana. So he was president when Kennedy was in office. Kennedy actually did help, allocate funds to create a dam, a great dam in Ghana, which was only accomplished in 1966. So 2 years after he was dead, so he never saw it completed, but this was a great project for Western Africa. And Kwame Nkrumah, you should know, I don't remember exactly, but I believe in Cynthia's presentation on the non-aligned group, non-aligned movement, he was a major part of that, of trying to actually not go on either side, but really try to create republics in Africa, the Pan-African movement that really, he was one of the thinker and fighters of the Pan-African movement. There's also the presentation that Nick gave on Sheikh Entadyap, which is also, that goes into these questions a lot. So Kennedy knew these guys. He knew Kwame Nkrumah, he knew Sekou Toure, who was the president of Guinea, who had broken from France also just right before or around the election of Kennedy. Enrico Mattei was an Italian industrialist who helped a lot in the development of great projects in Africa at the time. He was assassinated, unfortunately. Well, a lot of them were either overthrown or assassinated in the 60s. You remember Patrice Lumumba, I mentioned previously, was the president of the Congolese, the Democratic Republic, or Democratic Republic of Congo. And so he was assassinated just before Kennedy was inaugurated. You have Sukarno in Indonesia, who also there was a lot of discussion to have great projects, nuclear power exchange with countries of Southeast Asia. So these were all people that, you know, understood what Kennedy was trying to do, and were trying to get on that side, on the progress side, collaborate on that at that level. Nasser in Egypt, obviously the fight that had been waged, in that area against the British and the French. At the time of the Suez Canal crisis, that was under Eisenhower, but you know there was still this spirit in Egypt at the time. And Kennedy, I didn't mention it before, but when he wrote his paper in 1957 on the imperialism as the enemy. He was taking the side of the Algerian independence movement against the French. And that's something that De Gaulle also had to move in and settle when in 1958, when he came back to power. There was an attempt to overthrow him. And that's basically when Kennedy fired Alan Dulles from the CIA. And replaced them. So that's in 1961. It's after the Bay of Pigs, and there was an attempt to coup in Algiers, in the capital of Algeria, to have a putsch, a military overthrown of the government of Algeria, and basically to put De Gaulle outside, to put him in a crazy situation. So Kennedy was really against that, and he had a great understanding because he went around the world and understood the imperial faction, imperial problems that were generated in these countries. And he really fought against that. And that's what, as he said, you know, you need friends and then, you know, you have allies. And that's what he was trying to create at the time. And he had friends around the world. Obviously, you know, I had to say something a bit about the civil rights. Kennedy was fighting around the world, and he was fighting in the United States because he understood there were very like big shortcoming in the U.S. society, in the way things were conducted in his country. And so I really like this painting by Rockwell, Norman Rockwell. He's got great paintings. And this one was April 1st, 1961 on the Saturday Evening Post. I think that really went hand in hand with what Kennedy was trying to do at the time. And clearly Rockwell probably understood what Kennedy was doing and remembered the FDR era. And Kennedy had to intervene, you know, to try to get people to understand this the golden principle: do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That was something that was there's clearly part of the policies, a main driving principle. And between 1961 and 63, Kennedy had to intervene lots of times at many different occasions to send the military, the soldiers, or the National Guards to break segregationist state rules, especially in Alabama, to get, black students to be able to go to school That's, you know, that was still the situation in the 1960s. And so there were all the troubles around the world, but there, you know, clearly something had to be done in the United States to organize the population. And, you know, so Kennedy intervened in different ways, you'll see. And, you know, it was the time when Martin Luther King was giving his speech, I Have a Dream, in August 1963. 200,000 American, you know, walked in Washington. So that was the time. And Kennedy moved on that. Next slide. So one way he intervened for the civil rights and really universal rights was to present, you know, give a report to the American people what had been done in the past years, past decades, and what still needed to be done. Why he had sent, you see that's June 11, 1963, why he had sent the National Guards in Alabama once again. You know, what was the problem? So he delivered a speech from the Oval Office to the nation, to the American people. And I just excerpted these few words. He said, "The rights of every man are diminished when the rights of one man are threatened. He said also, we are in a worldwide struggle to protect those who wish to be free. We are confronted primarily with a moral issue. It is as old as the scriptures and as clear as the American Constitution. Whether we will treat our fellow Americans as we want to be treated." And so that goes back to, you know, the golden rule, what the painting of Rockwell was mentioning before. I'm almost done, guys. Don't worry. We'll have time for questions. So he did that in the United States. And he also brought forth, you know, these projects. He really tried to get the Soviet Union to calm down because you know, well, there was a lot of agitation trying to get more wars. And of course, Vietnam was on his mind. There was a lot of different attempts to get the United States more involved. They were already involved when Kennedy came into office. Actually, they had been involved since the end of the Second World War in Southwest Asia, or Southeast Asia, sorry. But Kennedy's plan was not to go full on in a civil war in Vietnam. That's what I believe he was told by MacArthur to not to go in Vietnam. And he understood that it would not be a good situation, a winning situation. So he went to the UN General Assembly on September 20th, 1963, and delivered a speech. And I just excerpted again a small part, which I thought was very interesting. He said, "Today we may have reached a pause in the Cold War. And if we fail to make the most of this moment and this momentum, then the indictment of posterity will rightly point its finger at us all. Let us stretch this pause into a period of cooperation." And so he also mentioned to the world that the space programs should be shared. They should be countries should work together. And so the United States and Soviet Union would have much better success if they were to work together instead of spending to build, you know, twice twice as much, you know, to do everything on their side. So he really had this idea of cooperation, not just with the third world, to get them, you know, up to a good start, really, for the 20th century, out of the British Empire, French Empire, Dutch Empire, every empire, destroy colonialism, as FDR, you know, as his fight had been during World War II, and what was intended after that. And so Kennedy was really going back to this, and breaking with what Truman and the British had been doing and were still doing in his back at the time. And it just, I feel it's just too bad he wasn't able to accomplish it, that he was stopped in his track. So I'm just going to stop there for now.
Pascal, that was wonderful. Well, thank you very much. And that's, I think, a perfect way to follow up on the resource that you created for everyone to use with your last class on Franklin Roosevelt. It touches on so many core dimensions that are often overlooked, a very multiply connected thing. So I very much appreciate that you put this on the record. We have time for some questions. So I've noticed here in the chat area that Magdalena had the first thought she wished to share. So it's all yours, yes. Madeline.
Yes, okay. That was fantastic. I really much appreciate that, what you did. I just wanted to, as a kind of explanation of the mood at a time, relay an anecdote from when I was a kid. When I was 5 years old, that kind of, it times me the whole thing. but when I was 5 years old, that's when JFK got assassinated. And I just want to say, I mean, growing up in Europe, that was a time coming after World War II when there was lots of desperation, lots of poverty, lots of rebuilding was taking place. And when Jeff, I remember very, very clearly when the day that it was announced that JFK was assassinated, my mom started crying. Okay, and I had never seen my mom cry, but she cried when she heard the news about the JFK assassination. And so this is in Switzerland. This is not over here. This is not in the United States, right? The impact of this assassination was very, very internationally, very heartfelt, right? And another memory is my grandmother, who lived upstairs from us, she had a plate on the wall, you know, one of those memory plates of people. And that's the only plate she ever had. And that was with JFK's face on it, right? Mm. So this idea that JFK gave hope to people because of what he was discussing, what he was bringing forth as an idea for a purpose of a nation. Mm-hmm. And that it moved people across the ocean. So right. Thank you very much, Pascal.
Thank you. Yeah, it's true. I'm too young, so I don't have these anecdotes, but that's what I heard from a lot of people over the years. I mean, I was finishing high school when 9/11 happened, and I think, you know, in my lifetime, that's kind of the, you know, something, a shock that was given to my generation. That's, you know, a bit like what people in the 60s lived with Kennedy, except, you know, it was, you know, you can't compare Kennedy with the Twin Towers. Certainly, but it's something that, you know, everybody, I guess, from my generation can tell, you know, where they were when they heard about 9/11. I think, you know, the generation in the 60s they can tell you where they were when they learned about Kennedy's assassination.
Yeah, I would just add one thing that I think the thing that I was really touched by in your presentation is that, and it's fitting that you called your each presentation Act One and Act Two, because there was a real sense of drama and tragedy, which is, I think, any proper historian has to have that sense within them of the tragedy of history in order to feel that proper moral pain needed to empower oneself to moral action, to see like what should have been, what could have been, but what wasn't, instead of just treating history as like a sequence of things that just happened and had to be the way they were. So I do like that counterpoint that you were able to bring about on a variety of levels. 9/11 was, it lacked a bit of the tragedy because there wasn't, unlike the case of JFK, there wasn't the positive orientation that was snuffed out. It was really just negative all the way through, but it was definitely
Can I comment traumatic. On that?
You can quickly, and then we're going to go to Luke and
Satan. All right. Just to tell you where I was on college campus, small liberal arts in New Jersey. And it had big consequences for me because when I got out, when I finally graduated, I was drafted about a year later. So I knew that there were consequences when when Kennedy was shot and Johnson was taken over. That's it.
Thanks.
Pascal, do I call on Luke or do you have a thought to that?
I call on John, yeah.
Yeah, okay, cool. Luke?
Yeah, it's probably an easy question for you, but if JFK were president today, how do you believe he would deal with Julian Assange?
Oh, God. I don't know. How do you think you would deal with him?
Free him.
Absolutely.
Yes.
I feel like the consensus is vectoring on free him, yes.
Hands down.
I hope that's what you would do, but you know,
yeah.
It's a...
Luke is a softball champion.
Yeah, Luke, you're going to have to work on your polemic there.
All right, Satomi.
Yeah, I agree with Madalena. There's not one person I know of that does not remember where they were when JFK died. And that wasn't even political, but it's so vivid in my memory. But I think that for our generation, because it's, you know, like FDR and maybe Lincoln's assassination wasn't as personal because we actually experienced it. And I think it lives so much more in the memory. And I think that it will, and it's great to see the continuation of Lincoln and then FDR and then continuing on with JFK. But I think that this was a really defining moment in our whole generation, and it's not going to end until we get to the total bottom of it. I don't know why I'm so fascinated, you know, I can't put it down. It's just something that just is so ingrained in my memory. And so, you know, that's how I think everyone of my generation that lived through that and remember it, because, you know, I just graduated from school. This is probably one of the big, no, maybe it wasn't the biggest mistake of the people that, you know, the forces that did this, because it's not going to go away. I really feel that deep down until, you know, the whole truth comes out, because it still has so much ramifications today. But I guess my question is, what is, you know, similar, and what do you think is different about the things that JFK was dealing at that time and with today? And thank you so, Pascal, too, for, you know, bringing all this, tying it together with FDR and JFK.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, it's great. Thank you. It's something, you know, I think what people have to think about is really, yeah, I mean, you know, there's, it's always hard to say, well, you know, what would have happened, because, well, it didn't happen, so we don't know, you know, but there's obviously clear indications if you look at what Kennedy was saying, what he was doing, of where he was going, and where the world would have gone if, you know, if these, you know, think about all of the assassinations which happened in the 60s. If all of this had not happened, well, clearly the world would be such a different place. I mean, but it's interesting, you know, still today, you look at how politics is being run, and really what Kennedy was fighting against, not just in the United States, but, you know, on the international stage, but, you know, but especially in the United States, the party line, this idea that, you know, you got to go along to get along. That's why he wrote Profiles in Courage. That's because he was told when he got into the Senate that, you know, if you want to stick there, well, you just go along, you know, you go along to get along. You follow the policies of the party, and, you know, the whip is going to tell you what to vote on, you know, what you don't vote on, when you stay home or whatever, you know. And that's what, you know, Kennedy really had in horror. And he really thought, you know, since he was a soldier in World War II, he really thought that, you know, wars had, you know, to be avoided at all costs, because, you know, he understood it. He had been there. And one funny, you know, he had great wit. That's also something, you know, if you want to listen to something great, Kennedy was really funny. And I'm not that funny. That's why I just put the cartoon at the beginning of my presentation. But Kennedy was really funny. He really had a great wit. And some say that it came from him being sick a lot when he was younger. And when he was injured after the war. But, you know, there's just people like that just, they emanate, they, you know, there's just this aura around them, and they're just great. You know, it's not often that you get these kinds of leaders. He just, you know, to go back to this funny thing, he said, you know, they gave me a medal. I, you know, it's kind of strange. You get a medal for having your ship sunk in the Pacific. That's, you know, yeah, obviously that's not just what happened. You know, he was, he actually rescued members of his crew when the PT boat was ran through, you know, by the Japanese, but he was able to turn that into a joke. Just saying, you know, well, it's that, you know, self-deprecating. I just thought, you know, that's true what you said. It's it was a great character, and something, you know, that people have to go back to, even though, you know, it's hard to find in the literature. It's hard to understand when you read books about him, because it's been blurred so much. And to this day, you know, if you talk to the Russians, oh God, it's not good. The media is, you know, they will tell you, don't talk to the Russians. And it comes from there, really. That's
I think they know.
Understood it, you know.
Mm-hmm. I think they know.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. Of course, they won't say, but I think they have records. Maybe that's what they hold him against. You know, everybody has their little trump card that they hold.
Yeah.
Or so, their insurance.
Yeah. So that's what I would say for that for now.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
All right. I think we have time for a last little batch of questions. So far on the list, I've got Paula, then Desiree, and finally Sam, I think. And at that point, we'll have to wrap it up unless there's something really pressing. So, Paula.
Hi.
Oh, we can't hear you.
Paula, you might be on mute. To unmute, you have to go to the bottom left-hand side of your screen.
Oh, yeah, you're not muted by that. You're muted by something else.
Oh, Paula, you're not on mute. Look at that. All right, so let's move on to Desiree. And Paula, if you can figure out how the audio works, then we'll come back to you. So, Desiree?
So, can you hear me?
Sure.
Okay. My question is, and I think it's a little controversial, because I was a teenager at the time in growing up in Guyana when Kennedy was, I think, before our independence. And the person who was to be prime minister was Chetty Jagan, a very good guy. But the British, because he was married to an American who was communist, or of the Communist Party, there was a lot of controversy around it. And the British put a lot of pressure on Kennedy to get Jagan out of power. And that, I'd like to know a bit more about.
Oh boy, I'm not sure I'm gonna be able to answer that.
Not now, but.
Yeah, okay, not now.
yeah. But there was a lot of controversy because his American wife was the Communist Party.
Okay.
Or on the left, whatever. Mm-hmm. The British put a lot of pressure on Kennedy to try and do something about it and get him out of power. And this is how they got Burnham into being the first president.
Okay. Well, that's something I'm not aware.
It was a really I never knew about it until a few years ago.
Okay.
And I was really, really shocked. Really shocked about it.
Yeah, I would just you know, I don't know the specific case you're mentioning.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, they were all about communism in South America, and things like that, and. I'm not sure. Apparently, there's a lot of material in Congress, in the U.S. Congress, that is to do with that. And in one video, somebody was saying they don't know why Kennedy was so focused on Guyana at that time and communism. Well, I can understand the communism part.
Yeah. Well, you know, I would just... my two cents on that would be to look at the connection with the Dulleses, what they had been doing before Kennedy came into office.
Okay.
And also, you know, think about the idea that, you know, if basically Kennedy was really attacked for being soft on the communists. Mm. I don't think it's true, but you know, if you were an FDR Democrat at the time, you were like a communist, like that's how they were treated. So Kennedy was able to get in, but as you saw on the leaflet, he was seen as a traitor. Mm. FDR was seen as a traitor because he came, you know, from the Hyde Park Roosevelt and, you know, this established family, patrician family. So same thing with Kennedy. You become a president, you're from a good family. Mm-hmm. The establishment, but you're not supposed to rock the boat, and Kennedy was not seeing it that way. So I don't know exactly what happened. Mm-hmm. But that's how I would try to look at it.
Mm. Okay,
can I just say quickly though, I think that the reason with Kennedy against communism was really within because I think there really was an infiltration of not even maybe fascists that was within the White House in many, many key positions. I think that was why, you know.
Well, there's a lot that could be said on this. I would just, there's probably a good material for another presentation on McCarthyism. Mm. Because, you know, what happened because I touched on that, you know, I mentioned Truman, the Dulleses and all that. It's hard, you know, to focus on all of these in one presentation. It's certainly something to look into because between FDR, Truman, Eisenhower, and Kennedy, you know, a lot of things were done that shifted the focus in terms of the homeland policies, you know, internal policies of the United States, but also the foreign policies. And that's where, you know, this Anglophile faction that's where the crux of the BS.
Mm. But, you know, Chetty was a really good guy, would have been a really great leader. They got Burnham in, and Burnham did exactly what they didn't want him to do, turn communist, and was a dictator.
Mm. Okay.
So. All right, let's try Paula, if you're able to fix your mic.
Is that okay? Can you hear me now?
Oh yeah, that's good.
Can you? Okay, thank you very much. And second of all, my question might be a bit naive, but still, what do you think Kennedy has got it wrong when it comes to fight big powers? Why Kennedy didn't make it and Trump did, so to speak, if the comparison makes any sense.
Well, I'm not sure Trump, you know. Okay, let's take it from Kennedy. Certainly, you know, if you go back to FDR, they tried to kill him before he got inaugurated. So the British... The oligarchical faction knew in the United States, in London, everywhere, in their centers of power, that FDR was not good for them. Now, with his policies, now they had to accommodate with him because it was the crisis, and eventually they figured out that, you know, the monsters they had created in Europe were unleashed and unstoppable. So they had to get along with FDR, but I think they learned from that lesson that you don't go too far, you know, getting along with your with that kind of president of the United States. So I think that's why Kennedy was shot, you know, so fast. There were probably different attempts before that. I'm not too sure. There's always attempts at the president. I mean, you know, he's always threatened, but they were able to do it because they understood what he represented, and they wanted to stop it right then, you know. And then exactly the same for the other assassinations of the 60s, you know, Malcolm X, MLK, and others, you know, and all the other political leaders around the world that I mentioned that were allied with Kennedy, or at least, you know, knew where he was going and wanted to be in on that. And for Trump, I'm not too sure. You know, he's still alive. Good for him. But I'm not too sure, you know, that lots of things have changed. I think there was an intention. I think a lot of Americans have awakened at what's going on, but I'm not sure that it was done in the best way. Right.
Paula's thumbs up indicates that she approves. Okay, so let's end with Sam, who has a thought or a question to throw out there.
All right, great.
Sam, Monsieur Leberrier, are you still there?
Is he driving?
He was driving. But I see his name.
He was driving, but I'm here now. Pascal, thank you so much for... the class. I really enjoyed
the subject. A lot of the quotes that you brought up, his opposition to Malthus, for whatever, I think is crucial. It was just I just had a thought, because it's kind of well timed for me. I picked up the Devil's Chessboard to reread again. Fantastic book by David Talbot on Alan Dulles. And recently was watching some documentaries about Permindex and Clay Shaw and the Centro Mondiale Commerciale that was so so involved, not just in the assassination of Kennedy, but was actively trying to assassinate Charles de Gaulle as well. Mm-hmm. And ran these this Operation Gladio, creating this strategy of tension in Europe. Mm-hmm. And I just found it really interesting. I agree completely on the focus on Dulles, because as the book Devil's Chessboard makes clear, Alan Dulles from World War II was very much on the side of making a deal with the Nazis to keep Nazi Germany alive and an ally of the United States against Soviet Russia. When FDR announced the unconditional surrender policy, Dulles called it a disaster. He said it's an absolute disaster that FDR is saying that Germany has to surrender unconditionally. He was fighting up until the end of the war against the policy of his own commander-in-chief, FDR, trying to make deals with high-level Nazi figures where the U.S. would keep the leadership of Nazi Germany in place as an ally against communism. And, you know, Dulles and his brother continued this policy in allying with their allies in the British Empire, who, you know, who Dulles cultivated through World War II. His association, he was high up in the OSS and in U.S. intelligence. So all his networks with British intelligence. And I just find it really interesting because this this CMC in Italy that was associated with Clay Shaw and Permindex, it was founded by the European Nazi movement, what was left of it. You know, there was still a strong Nazi movement in Italy, which the CIA completely supported because they didn't want the communists to come into power. Dulles completely supported them. And, you know, this whole assassination network, I mean, there was a big network involved in the assassination of JFK. But, I mean, central to it was this pro-fascist network. And I think the history of Alan Dulles needs to be rewritten. You know, the realization of just how diabolical of a person he was, it's really not there yet in the American mind.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. That's very important to mention. I mean, I couldn't really go that much in detail, but there's so much, you know. If we get into the assassination plot, that's like another presentation or two, and but it's you know, there's a lot of good work that have been done. I'm just thinking about there's a great interview that Jeff Steinberg did with Colonel Prouty. That's very it's very interesting just to listen to that and think about, you know, everything that's been, that you've heard from the media and the you know, the history books, what's the mainstream line on what Kennedy was doing. but there's so much that is not said and it has just been covered up or not mentioned, and that Kennedy was fighting against and actually exposing. You know, he was mentioning when I used these quotes from the 1940s and 50s before he became president, as he was entering the Congress and the Senate, he really had an understanding of the British Empire and what imperialism was doing around the world. But it's not something that people understand today. It's not something that's discussed today. And it's something that, you know, was able to morph in the United States right after the death of FDR. They really like created this this parallel government, or, you know, what people called the deep state, with the intelligence services at the time, you know, the OSS becoming the CIA and all that. And you're right, the figure of Dulles, I think there's, you know, not just to focus on him, but, you know, to really understand exactly, you know, what his part was in this imperial scheme. And you're right, like, why I mentioned the Prouty interview is because he was there flying these Nazis from Eastern Europe into different other theater, or bringing them back to the United States. And because, you know, the Cold War was already started when FDR died. That's what was going on. But we don't really hear about that these days.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And, great yes, class. Thank you. Yeah, just wanted to say it was a great class. And what you mentioned about Eisenhower and his final remarks, it's true. Yeah, he kind of said, oh, yeah, I did my 8 years and didn't do anything about it, but here's what I'm leaving you. But it's interesting how, you know, not even 3 years after he made those remarks where he said, you know, this new military industrial complex, we can't ever let it affect our democratic institutions, other than that, well, we saw exactly that happen with the assassination of Kennedy.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. What I'll do for anybody who wants to dig into a lot of what's being raised here in even more detail, in the description under this video, I'm going to put a whole bunch of resources, including a brilliant trilogy recently written by Cynthia Chung on JFK versus the Leviathan, going through the Gehlen networks, utilizing a lot of the David Talbot work, as well as Jim Garrison and Prouty's works. Really comprehensive, good trilogy. So check that stuff out in the description box. We'll also have speeches. So Pascal, don't forget to send me the best speeches that you could find of JFK that people could listen to for inspiration. It's very edifying, good for the soul. And we'll put that there too. Next week, we will begin our fifth movement of this little symphony of classes with the theme of bridging the East-West divide. Dr. David Wang will be delivering next week's class on China and the founding of the United States, with a big focus on Benjamin Franklin's relationship to Confucius and Confucianism. We'll have a presentation by Dr. Quan Le on statecraft in modern-day China, from Sun Yat-sen to the New Silk Road, followed by something by Jeffrey Steinberg on the American-Russian paradox, a big sweeping history of U.S.-Russian relations, followed by something special to end it all off by Jerry Therrien. So Pascal, thank you enormously for taking the time and elucidating this part of history for all of us.
Thanks, Pascal.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Pascal.
Thank you.
Thanks, Pascal.
See you at the reading.
Thanks, Pascal.
Thank you. See you soon.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks.